gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
You're listening to Nosebleed Radio. Here's your host, Tucker Franklin.
What's up, episode 7 of Nosebleed Radio is live. I'm here with the boys, Kieran Brennan.
How's it going?
Toby Todd.
What's up?
And Shane Miller.
Hey, how's it going, Roll Hawks?
Got a great interview with Mike Magnante coming up later. We're on spring break here at Nosebleed Radio. It's our spring break episode. We're recording this ahead of time. So we're going to start off with our favorite number sevens. Fellas, who wants to kick us off?
I'll kick us off with everybody's favorite number seven, 2006 World Series major contributor, Mr. Ronnie Belliard. And then I'm going to follow up with Cardinals' Matt Holliday, and then go to Mr. Jacoby Brissett.
I've got Cristiano Ronaldo. We've never mentioned soccer here, so right. Good first one. Cristiano Ronaldo, one of the greatest soccer players of all time, and just a pretty dope dude in general. Then I've got a little biased homer pick here, Kalik Hudson for Michigan, as well as Tarik Black, receiver for Michigan this year. Dynamic duo, number seven, is going to be our both players on both sides of the ball next season.
Ronaldo is also a world-class tax evader, too, so that's kind of nice to notice. We never talked about tax evasion before on this show. But coming from a Nebraska standpoint, I'm currently wearing a Nebraska jersey. I'm going to go with two number sevens, first one being Scott Frost, former champion and current head coach at Nebraska. And then I'm going to follow that up with Eric Crouch. I actually used to live next to him, or not next to him, down the street from him, so I got to know him kind of well. And also a great number seven at Nebraska. Third one I've got, because 777 is a jackpot. Rugby sevens. So that's kind of interesting to talk about. I like
clever.
Those. Yeah.
Cover. I've only got one. Mike Vick. One of the greatest mobile quarterbacks of all time. Hey, now.
He did his time. I forgive him.
Do you think his seventh dog was the best one?
Lucky number seven.
We kind of have like an unlucky number seven right now, since we mentioned like tax evader Cristiano Ronaldo. We've got Mike Vick in the past. There's also Ben Roethlisberger, you know, allegedly.
Allegedly. Let's not forget John Elway, though.
Boo. Boo Broncos.
Probably the worst teeth to ever play quarterback in John Elway.
I was about to say that those teeth are pretty unfortunate if we're going on unfortunate number sevens.
He was the perfect quarterback to be drafted by the Broncos since he has horse teeth.
Yeah, I was going to say he is the perfect quarterback to run in the Kentucky Derby.
The other team he was going to get drafted by was the Colts, another horse team, so he would have fit in there, too.
Anti-Broncos podcast.
Anti-Broncos podcast. Officially. Kieran has to declare it.
Also, an anti-tax evasion podcast. I'm gonna go out and say that. I think we can all agree on that.
We have to start adding some pros, because we are way too anti on like everything.
we're a pro Bonnie's podcast.
Well, we are pro Bonnie's podcast. Bonnie up.
Yep, Bonnie up.
Also, pro football podcast.
We're a pro anti-tax evasion podcast.
Another number seven is Randall Cunningham. While you may not think of him as a number seven, he did wear number seven for 2 years, 1 year for the Dallas Cowboys and another one for the Minnesota Vikings.
The copy of backyard football that I had, I always drafted Cunningham to be my quarterback, and he would throw it to Pablo Sanchez. And on lunch pail, that'd be a touchdown every time.
Mm-hmm. Since it's spring break, we're going to go ahead and do something a little bit different. We're going to go ahead and get into our interview with Mike Magnante, and then we'll just do straight mailbag questions. We'll answer the questions we got from you. So here's our interview with Mike Magnante. We're here with our guest, former Royals pitcher Mike Magnante, and we're going to go ahead and start off with this question. Mike, how many announcers in your life have mispronounced your name?
Well, I mean, a fair amount, although even within my own family, we don't all say it the same way. My mom was an elementary school teacher, and the kids couldn't say it. And so for her class, she was Mrs. Magnetti, which is just different letters and different names. My dad was a high school teacher, which is going to the way I say it now. He just said three syllables. My grandmother, the correct way to say it is Magnante.
Ooh,
this is Italian.
I like that.
The only person that ever did that was Joe Garagiola.
Really?
The only one.
Yeah.
My grandmother loved him because of it. for me, it didn't matter. All that mattered is that if they were saying my name, it meant I was still in the big leagues.
That's true. That's true.
So who is the best player you've ever struck out? We were kind of curious.
The best player I ever struck out?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. You know, that's a good question, because it's not like I struck out that many people, and it's funny because it doesn't really matter, because that's part of the game, just like giving up a home run.
Sure.
But, gosh, trying to think off the top of my head, you know, I don't even know off the top of my head. I never struck out A-Rod. I know that. He did pretty well.
Yeah, that's hard to strike out.
And same with Puckett. But I did really, did I strike out Harold Baines? I was pretty good against Harold Baines. I know that.
That's a good one.
In my day. But I don't, like I said, strikeout was not really a part of my game. It kind of happened by accident. And so, honestly, I can't even begin to tell you who would be the best.
Were there any guys that you just, like, you hated going up against them? You hated them walking and watching the batter's box?
Well, yeah. I mean, well, the guys that I obviously couldn't get out. Mike Piazza was 2-for-2 against me with a grand slam and a 3-run home run.
Ooh,
so that wasn't very good.
That's not good.
Yeah. And then, like I said, and Kirby Puckett was the other guy. I mean, I got him out a couple of times, but every out was hit really, really hard. So those two guys were guys that were not good for me to face.
Yeah. Well, an out's an out, though, so at least you got him out.
Yeah.
So on August 22nd of 97, you became the 29th pitcher to strike out 3 batters on 9 pitches. What was that like?
Well, you probably won't believe this, but nobody knew I did it, including myself. So it was a game where I was just getting work. That's all that it was. You know, I think we had a large lead at the time, or we were losing by a lot, but I think we had a lead. And so I'm getting an inning of work, and I threw my inning, and the game ends. And I go in the locker room, and then when the game ends, the reporters start coming over to me and like, "What are you doing?" And then they told me. And I had no idea. Nobody else on the team knew. I have the videotape from the game, and they don't even show the last pitch.
Really?
They're in the stands talking. So nobody knew at the time that I actually did it.
Wow.
And so other than getting to brag about it with my friend Billy Wagner, he was a strikeout guy. Right, and I don't know if he ever did it, but he had never done it at that point. So other than getting to make fun of him for me doing it, strikeouts for me were really more of an accident. I didn't even think of a strikeout unless I had 2 strikes on
right.
that.
Right, yeah.
The 3-pitch inning was better.
Yeah,
And I did have one of those.
Who's your favorite teammate to be in the clubhouse with? Do you have any guys that you really got along well with or just made?
And I kind of mentioned him. Billy Wagner was definitely my closest friend over the course of the career, you know, and to continue. But of course, like when I first came up in Kansas City, the pitchers tend to take care of pitchers. And the guys that really took care of me were, at the time was Mark Davis in the bullpen. And then 2 starting pitchers, Mike Boddicker and Mark Gubiza, and I do too, the right way to approach the game of baseball. And then, like I say, Billy has certainly been my closest friend from my days in Houston.
You know, Mark Gubiza is one of the great Royals pitchers. You know, how did he kind of help you in Kansas City a little bit besides just like mentoring you?
It was really just little things, even in early. So when you come up, that was a very veteran team. I was a young guy, one of the handful. And I remember one day somebody was one of the starting pitchers was doing the bucket. I'm in the outfield shagging, and I remember Gooby coming over and just going, you know, little things like, "Hey, Mike, you know, don't have to do it. It's not a big deal, but it might look good if you went in and did the bucket for whoever that was up there," which was no big deal. Well, I did it, but it was amazing how many of the veteran players realized it, and in the locker room, people coming up, "Hey, good job doing that for him," and all of a sudden, you know. It made it easier to fit in. And it was just, like I say, it was those little things like that, you know, don't throw your dirty clothes on the floor. Get it into the laundry basket. You know, little things, you know, treat people the way they should be treated, not that you're the big leaguer and this is just somebody working in the locker room. And I think a lot of it was that because you need so much help to be successful in the major leagues. And that help, you get some of it from coaches, certainly. But the vast majority of the help you get is from your teammates, both pitchers and hitters. How do you face somebody? You can learn so much from a hitter on how to get somebody else out, but they have to be willing to do it for you. And if you come in, and in my opinion, and you're like over cocky and all this stuff, they're less likely to give you that. But if you show maybe a little humility and do a few little things, maybe a little dirty jobs here or there, all of a sudden, those guys are the guys that they want to help you out.
That's awesome.
Yeah. You mentioned that you're a bullpen pitcher. What was like bullpens like during just a regular game in the middle of July? What would you do in the bullpen?
Well, every city was a little bit different, when I first came up, I was a starter, and I remember the bullpen in Kansas City, the veteran guys would go underneath the stands. Back then, it's mm-hmm. not as nice as it is now. But they had a room back there where the grounds crew guys had their stuff, and they had TV. So I would never go back there because I was a young guy.
Right.
And I remember Kevin Apier was struggling one day, and he kept getting into trouble, and then he'd get out of trouble, back and forth. But I knew I was the long guy, and I was constantly stretching and getting who am I facing? I'm going to be the guy in. Well, I never ended up pitching a game. He kept getting out of jams. And the next night, the bullpen coach, Glenn Ezell, at the time, he goes, I watched you yesterday. He goes, mentally, you were in that game five times. He goes, if we'd have put you out there, you wouldn't have been any good. You were mentally fatigued, basically. And he's right. And he made me start going underneath the stands and hanging with the other guys. And he told me that he would take care of me. The reason I say that is that it is. It's very hard to focus for 3 hours. You have to focus in bits and pieces. And so when people see maybe bullpen fooling around or they think they're fooling around, it's really just a way to relax. And, you know, probably best when I was with the Royals, not the Royals, the Oakland A's, I used to go to the bullpen for the national anthem. And then we were allowed to go back in the locker room because it was cold and damp there. And I'd go in the locker room until about the fifth inning because I knew I wasn't going to pitch until the sixth. But when mm-hmm. I came back down in the fifth inning, I was focused for the sixth, seventh, and eighth on what the situation, what was coming up. And as I was starting to focus, those long guys were now screwing around. You know, their day was kind of done. And then got to the ninth, my period's kind of over unless we go extra inning. Mm-hmm. And then the closer. And so there's a lot of fun. And every place you can do different things, talk to different people or talk to people in the stands in Oakland because they're right there next to you.
Yeah.
But I can tell you this much. Those guys have a good idea when it's their chance to pitch. And really watch them. You'll see guys fooling around at different points in the game, and then all of a sudden somebody will stop having a good time or stop relaxing, and then they start getting intent for a little bit, and then when their period ends, another guy does it.
That's pretty neat.
Yeah, that's a super interesting point. I think a lot of people, they don't understand that aspect of it where you do have to keep yourself loose and like keep yourself focused, but at the same time you got to be able to have fun back there when you're in the bullpen so you're not stressed out for the full nine innings.
Well, you absolutely do. I remember there was a point in Kansas City we used to have sunflower seed wars. We'd be flicking seeds at each other. But that never occurred in the seventh inning. It never occurred in a one-run game. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you know, baseball long, and you, like I said, it's very hard, I think, for anybody in any situation to focus that much for that long, you know, for 3+ hours. It's very hard for anybody to do that and be really successful. You have to learn how to focus over short periods of time when you can do it, and I think that's what players learn to do over time. And hitters are the same way, by the way. Yeah. And when they're not coming up to hit and they're on the bench, now they're fooling around too, or whatever, or not as focused at least. But when as they start getting two or three batters away, all of a sudden those guys start focusing in again.
Yeah, yeah. And you mentioned how it's different from city to city. What was your favorite city to play in?
Well, I think as a home player, I'd have to say it was Houston. Houston, a couple of reasons. One, we were very good.
Yeah.
The one year we had the best record in baseball regular season. At the same time, we were all about the same age, which was kind of unique. You know, we weren't really young, but nobody was really old, you know, either. You know, a lot of in Kansas City, it was all over the map. You know, we started very old with a few young guys. By the end, we were very young everywhere. You know, Oakland, I was an old guy in Oakland.
Yeah.
We had a lot of guys that were like 23, 24 years old. Not that that's bad by any stretch, but when you have this unique little group of 25 guys that are all within 3 or 4 or 5 years of each other, we all had young kids. You know, that's when my oldest son was born, but there was a ton of young kids, and then we're good at the same time. That makes things kind of nice.
Right.
Do you have a least favorite city to play in, like maybe on away games?
Well, I have definitely a least favorite park to pitch in.
Yeah.
Mm.
For me, it was easy. It was Fenway. Much as I like Fenway, I didn't want to pitch there. If you looked at my ERA there, it's like double the next closest. Great city. Love the city. But I didn't want to pitch there, that's for sure. And on the opposite end of Baltimore, which is not a good pitcher's park, but I love going to that place, you know, to pitch. I mean, as far as just visiting a city, I don't know. I think everybody's a little bit different, and the teams were different. You know, Houston encouraged us pitchers to go play golf on the road. And the reason they did that was that they knew if we were playing golf, that meant we weren't staying out late and going to bars and drinking.
That's true, yeah.
The Royals were anti-golf when I was there. Or we could play, we just couldn't take our golf club. You know, and so every team has different, you know, rules, which is fine. Right, just follow the rules that go with us. But, like, as a visiting player, when I was with the Royals, a horrible place to go was Oakland because we stayed in Oakland.
Yeah.
When I got to the Angels, when we went to Oakland, we stayed in San Francisco. It turned overnight into a really nice place to go, you know, type of a thing. So some of it also is just dependent on the location, you know, that you're staying, you know, if there's something to do nearby.
Very true.
And, like, for me, I wasn't a big nightlife guy, so it didn't matter. Like, New York being open, all the bars being open until, what, 6 a.m. or whatever, that didn't matter to me.
No.
I like places that I could walk around. So Seattle was one of my favorites. I could walk everywhere.
That was a cool experience to get as, like, a pro athlete. You get to see a lot of America that people sometimes don't get a chance to go out and do.
Well, you do, but you'd be amazed how much ball players, and myself included, for a lot of my career, waste that opportunity. It was a minor league. I got sent to the minor leagues 1 year, and the AAA trainer that brought it to my attention. But he said, you travel all over the country, and you stay up all night. You stay up till 3-4 in the morning and sleep until noon, and then get up, have breakfast or have lunch, and go to the ballpark. You never see him.
True.
And when he said that to me, it really, I probably was at the right time to hear it, and I started going to bed earlier so that I could get up and actually start. Seeing some of these cities, but I wish I would have done it earlier, especially with the minor league cities.
Sure.
You know, so we see a lot of nightlife in cities, maybe. Yeah. When it's dark.
So baseball, a lot of baseball players are very superstitious. Do you have any, like, pregame rituals or superstitions you live by or anything like that?
No, I can't say that I did. I mean, yeah, I certainly wore the same stuff, like the same stuff or whatever for the game, only until it started getting wrecked, and then once it started getting wrecked,
scrap it.
I changed it. It wasn't like it freaked me out if I didn't have it.
Yeah.
Which, you know, certainly, you know, other people, you know, obviously had.
Yeah, we talk about superstitions, and I know the starting pitchers are just creatures of habit. What was one of those starting pitchers?
Well, I think that's what it is. I mean, baseball, and probably all sports, you know, you're taught to do the same. You want to replicate everything.
Right.
And so then, of course, the problem with that is if you happen to have a personality that has a little bit of OCD in you, then you can kind of go over the deep end a little bit.
What's your favorite baseball movie?
My favorite baseball movie, to be honest with you, it's Field of Dreams.
That's a classic.
Oh, yeah.
And to be honest with you, it really comes down to one scene. There's a scene where Costner's playing catch with his dad.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And so, first of all, his dad in the movie looks very much like my dad did when he was young. I have old pictures of my dad. So he looks very similar to my dad to start with. And I started every year after in the off season, the very first time I ever played catch, every year I played catch with my dad. So it reminded me, you know, a lot of me, you know, and my dad. So that is one that I have a little special spot. I mean, it's obviously I like, you know, the funnier ones generally, but if I had to pick one, it would be that.
Now, another baseball movie that we like here is Moneyball. How did you feel about that movie coming out?
I was very nervous about it coming out. Well, actually, initially I was in it.
Mm-hmm.
They were originally going to do that with all of us playing ourselves.
Oh, really? Wow.
And we all had contracts. I literally, the night before, I was getting a call on a Saturday night. We were leaving next morning, and we were flying to Phoenix for spring training.
Oh, wow.
For the movie.
That's crazy.
And Steven Soderbergh was going to be the director, and I got the phone call, and it wasn't the one I was expecting, which was where to go. It was the one to say that Sony got nervous and pulled the plug.
Really?
because we weren't actors.
Sure, you're baseball players.
As far as the movie went, I was very nervous going into it. If you read the book, you know, the chapter related to me is not super flattering.
Right.
In terms of, you know, and there's some or falsehoods in there. It says that when they got rid of me, when the A's released me, I lost my pension. That wasn't true. It said that I was there were a lot of people that read in there that it made it sound like I didn't belong in the game. I don't know if that's true. I never really read the whole book. So there was a little bit of nervousness watching it, really, because my kids were in school at the time. And so how was that going to go over for them? As far as the way they treated my situation, I was perfectly fine with it. There was no suggestion of that. I got released, which is truly what happened. You know, as far as the movie goes, I don't think it's factual as far as the pieces that were put together, things like that. They merged about 3 or 4 years of stuff into one season. You know, it's what they did. And I know that that's the way movies work. So as far as that went, I came out smelling fine. You know, I always know when it comes on because my students will ask me about it whenever it comes on. And I get that's what they have to do. They put a lot of things together that happened over a pretty long period of time.
Right.
And unfortunately, I think they did a disservice to the hitters of that team. They made it sound like all they wanted to do was walk. That was the purpose, was to take pitches to get good counts so they could actually crush the ball.
Right.
You know, we had three unbelievable young pitchers in Mulder, Hudson, and Zito. They never get mentioned in the movie. You know, so I think that, you know, it was a movie that looked at one facet only of what, you know, of the game or of that story. Mm-hmm. And, like, for example, I think that their concept in Moneyball used to show, I thought the best part that they did with Moneyball was they drafted so well. And it came down to some of those stats, and they didn't do it that way. They only showed for picking up players, you know, cheap or whatever.
Yeah, and your manager, Art Howe, actually came out, kind of was upset with the movie, how it was portrayed, like, your whole situation, too.
Well, yeah, and Art was a great guy.
He got the worst portrayal of everybody.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a tall, skinny guy. He's obviously, the actor is short and pudgy. He's talking about never getting a contract again. I actually went back and researched a little bit of it after the movie, and Art was in the first year of a multi-year deal when that happened. He didn't have to worry about about that. And Art was a stand-up guy, and you know, I loved playing for Art, and you know, I mean, and the same thing, I think in the movie, you know, Billy releases me, Billy Bean, he didn't release me in real life, Art released me. I mean, it was Art's job to, you know, I mean, he was told to, I'm sure, you know, but I know that the movies are there to do one thing, which is to make money.
Right.
You know, and so they did, obviously, they made money, but like I say, a lot of us, and friends of mine that knew me, you know, I think the more people knew about the situation, I guess the less they enjoyed the movie because it wasn't exactly what happened.
Yeah.
You know, it's a good story, though.
You tested free agency a couple of times, especially with this year. Some players have had a hard time signing. What do you think the problem is there?
You know, I think you got a couple of things kind of going on. I mean, I think with more and more teams using the Moneyball concepts.
Right.
I think that probably plays some factor into it, just generally, or trying to be maybe a little bit, you know, more responsible fiscally. You know, I think that's going into it. I think for some of the guys, quite honestly, I think some of the guys might have overstated their worth.
Yeah.
I think it's a combination of 3 or 4 or 5 different things. You know, I think the problem when you get too statistical. So, like, when I first started playing, they probably weren't using stats enough, okay? And I think they probably swung around too far the other direction, to using them too much. You know, people have bad season doesn't mean that they're not going to bounce back and play great. Or, you know, or they've had an injury, or they have something you don't even know about. And stats don't talk about that, you know, type of a thing. And I think that there's too much of a reliance on it now. I think, for me, I think the Dodgers lost the World Series because of it.
Hmm.
The Dodgers burned out their bullpen in the first 2 or 3 games of the World Series by pulling their starters at 3 or 4 innings. And, you know, the relievers have already thrown a whole season, and now you have beat down pitching staff. That's just my opinion.
Right.
But I guess you'd say also that I'm probably fall into that old school mentality, you know?
Sure.
But I think it's just a combination of a lot of things, you know, going on. But I think that some of that is that they, you know, you have the number crunchers, and I'm not saying there's not validity to it.
Yeah.
But I think sometimes it gets overstated, but I think players also, you know, think it's time to cash in they want to get a five-year deal, but maybe the best you can do right now is a two-year deal or a one-year deal. And I think more guys could sign that way.
So speaking on statistics, do you think that the save statistic has ruined baseball, or how do you think that has affected the game?
I don't know. I mean, I don't think there's any good statistic for any reliever, first of all.
Yeah, I agree.
A save, when you if you put a guy out there with a three-run lead in the ninth, and he's actually a real closer, not somebody like me that filled in once in a while,
sure,
they should get the save. They're that good.
Right.
Right? Where if you bring a guy in with a one-run lead at a guy on third and less than two outs, you know, that's tough. But I, like I said, I can't think of a better, you know, better stats one way or the other. I know this. My friend Billy Wagner, he got hit in the head in Arizona. We were playing in Arizona. He got a line drive in the head. So he missed about 3 weeks. And we kind of did a committee, bullpen, closer by committee, but it was really two guys. It was myself and this guy, Jay Powell. And for the, when those 3 weeks are over, there was one thing that I knew. I don't care what those closers get. They're worth every bit of it.
Mm.
The pressure and the stress was amazing. One, I didn't have that type of stuff to be a closer. And but I found out that it was really nice to be pitching in the eighth inning, knowing that if I'm not perfect, Billy's going to come in and get me out of trouble. Yeah. But when you're the closer, there's nobody to come and get you out of trouble. And so, you know, maybe people think that they're coddled too much, maybe with the way the game is, you know, today. But the pressure that they play under, I mean, there's no in between for them. They either did their job or they're a goat. There's nothing else, right?
Yeah.
They don't get kudos because they got the save. They just did what they were supposed to do.
Uh-huh.
Right? Yeah. But if they blew the save, they're the goat. And if you blow three or four, you lose your job, you know, type of a thing. But like I said, for me, you know, you always think you can do it until you get stuck out there trying to do
it. Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And as soon as I got stuck out there trying to do it, I didn't have that many opportunities. And I think I had one or two that I got done, but I was like, forget this pressure. This isn't worth it. I'm happy to go back to the seventh.
Do you think, like, the stats and the sabermetrics of baseball, because baseball is a really number-centric game, do you think they kind of influenced you to be, like, a math teacher?
No, not from that standpoint. So I was an applied mathematics major at UCLA, and I graduated before I started playing pro ball.
Oh, wow.
Both of my parents were teachers. And so, you know, it was already kind of in my blood that way. I mean, that was not my intent when I got my degree. It was not to be a teacher. I was going to go work for like IBM or one of those.
Mm-hmm.
Baseball, in other words, getting that time in and making the money and being able to save money, it allowed me to be a teacher without salary being, you know, this big thing that's sitting over our head.
Right.
You know?
Right.
I think I always wanted, my parents were teachers. I always kind of wanted to be a teacher. Neither of my parents, I don't like to say they discouraged me, but neither encouraged me to doing it, because it seemed like one or the other was always, there was a possibility of maybe a strike, or we weren't hurting for things, but mm-hmm. It was very clear that we didn't have money to get my parents never had a new car. We never had a new car when I grew up. We didn't have bad cars, you know, but there was always, you always knew that there was money was a concern, and baseball allowed me to get rid of that part of it.
You hear a lot of stories about, like, pitchers and their relationship with their catcher. They have, like, a favorite catcher. Did you have a guy you really liked to have catch for you when you were pitching?
You know, I think on each team, you know, you had a preference.
Yeah.
But having said that, I mean, as a reliever, you know, as a relief pitcher, you know, you got no control, you know, over anything. And you're not out there for very long. With the Royals, I think I had 18 starts early in my career.
Mm-hmm.
And I was always going to get the most veteran catcher at that point because I was young and he knew the hitters, you know, type of a thing.
Right.
I think for me it would probably fall more to in the minor leagues in that sense. And I think, honestly, it came down to how no pitcher wants to shake off. Shaking off pitches takes time. At least I wanted to get moving. So the more you knew a guy or he knew you, the less you had to shake off, the more you're going to like him, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you're always having to balance – really the offense with the defense. So you may have a catcher that maybe doesn't block the ball quite as well, but he hits 300. Okay, well, I'll deal with a little bit less on the defensive side to get more on the offense, right? Because generally the backup catcher is a better defensive catcher than the starting catcher, at least when I was playing. You know, the starting catcher can hit.
Yeah.
And
so what's better? Would you rather have the better defensive catcher get some better stats but lose the game, or have the better hitting catcher and producing more runs?
Yeah,
yeah.
We've seen baseball kind of evolve here lately. Rob Manfred has done some pace of play rules. We really think that he hates the game of baseball. So, what are your thoughts on these new rules?
Well, I mean, I don't get too much into watching the rules. Like, for example, when they talked about putting a clock on the pitcher.
Right.
Okay, great. Not a problem. There's 1 second left, throw to first.
Yeah.
I think, to be honest with you, you could slow the game down even more, right? Because as a pitcher, if I was getting close on that, and they don't have the clock, but
right,
you're holding the ball. The reason you hold the ball is to freeze the hitter.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're down to 2 or 3 seconds, the hitter knows you're not freezing him. He knows the advantage has gone to the hitter. He knows
right.
The pitch is coming right now. So I'm going to stop it by finding a way around the rule. Right?
Yeah.
And that could be a pickoff. I don't know. You know, you have to get into the detail. Could you step off or not? I don't know the ins and outs. As far as, you know, the whole coming out to the mound, I don't think that's that big a deal.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't. They overuse it, and of course, because of the stats, we're using so many pitchers in every game now.
Yeah.
You know, which is slowing things down, you know, immensely. And I think, again, it's back to my argument that every time you bring a new pitcher in, the chance that guy doesn't have his good stuff goes up.
Right.
If you have somebody that's getting people out, they're in the big leagues. They can get people out. I don't care who it is. You know, that's what I believe. I don't know that you can if you limit the number of changes, then you've changed the course of the game.
Right.
You know, even if I disagree with the way they're kind of being run right now, I hate to see that. I know that when I played, if you pitched on ESPN back in the day, when there wasn't a whole lot of games on ESPN, the umpires would tell you, "Hey, Mike, take your time coming out in between innings. Don't forget, we got an extra minute on commercials." You know, and so you just sit. You know, most people, at least, I mean, you only get like 5 pitches between innings. This
right.
Makes,
yeah.
This is only 30 seconds. You know, for five or maybe 40 seconds for 5 pitches. Some of it's how much is that? I mean, so I guess what I'm saying is, if you could say, okay, we're going to do 1 minute between innings, I'm betting most pitchers would be fine with that.
Mm-hmm.
It's the commercials that wouldn't, but if you cut out a minute or two of commercials each inning, 9 innings on both sides, you just shorten the game.
Oh, absolutely. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
In a big way. I get it. I know that the money's coming from TV, and that's an important part of baseball. There's no doubt about it, but I think that a pitcher, I don't think a baseball player is that stupid. He'll find a way around the rule if he
right.
needs to.
Right.
So that's what I would have done. I would have figured out some way to get around some of it if I had to. But they don't have to go out to the mound as much as they're doing it. Let's put
right.
it that way.
Yeah.
You know, they're doing it because the managers, by and large, are not prepared.
True.
If the pitchers, True. If you, they're delaying to get a pitcher ready.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So yeah. I think that the manager may have to think a little farther ahead.
Well, can I ask you one last question here?
Sure.
How do you think that you would compare him to today's MLB?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think just like always, I think that there's a good chance that the athletes today are better than they were when I was playing. I think they certainly throw harder than I did. I don't know that that's always good. I pitched whatever the so-called, I guess, steroid era,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Benefited me because guys wanted to hit home runs, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you're going to try... I mean, I think in my career, going back into college, I gave up like a home run every 15 innings. So it wasn't very many. So I could use that aggressiveness against a hitter with my style of pitching.
Yeah.
Stay away, throw changeups away, stuff like that. It seems that a lot of guys don't mind striking out today. So that I could probably still use some of that against them, right?
Mm-hmm.
But who knows? Maybe today I'd be better because more guys are throwing harder. There's fewer people that pitch the way that I used to pitch.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
But I'm not going to try to say, I mean, there's no doubt in my mind that those kids are those not, they're not kids. The people playing today are probably a better athlete than I was in my day. And I think we were better athletes than the people 20 or 30 years before us, too. As a whole, I mean, you can always get the exceptional, and there were plenty of exceptions that in any
right.
day and age.
Oh, yeah.
Right? But I think that the game has gone to a power game, so maybe a little finesse guy like me that maybe had better command might do pretty well.
I agree.
Yeah, you never know.
Well, Mike, thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it. We had a great
sure
talk
thing.
Here.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was one of our best interviews, I think.
Oh, well, thank you. Anytime, you ever want to do it.
I'd love to get you come World Series time.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
There you go.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mike.
Sure thing.
A big thanks to Mike Magnante for coming on and talking with us. Fellas, let's get into the mailbag.
You've got mail.
Our first question: does Tim Tebow have a shot at making the Mets' big league roster? That's from Morgan from Grandview. So, fellas, does Tim Tebow have a shot at making it to the big leagues?
Well, through God, all things are possible, so...
Shut that down.
I think there are probably 27 other teams out there that he would not have a shot. But because he's on the Mets, yeah, he's got a pretty good shot. He's got as good of a shot to make the roster as David Wright does to play 10 games a year.
I think at this point the Mets are so desperate, they're like, why not get the guy who's got God on his side on our team? They need something. Do you ever see Angels in the outfield? You remember, yep, how good the Angels got when they got God on their side? That's what they're trying to do with Tebow right now. So they're trying to just build him up so they can get him in the stadium. It's going to put asses in the seats. Sorry, Mom, for cussing there. I think having God on your side is only a positive thing. So I think adding Tim Tebow is going to make it good for them.
They were good back in the day when they had the two demons in Doc and Daryl on their team. And so now they're just going the opposite direction. They're like, hey, we had the demons. Now we've hit kind of a lull. Time to go the other direction, get God.
If you look at Tim Tebow's spring training stats this year, not somebody you want on a big league roster, batting .056.
Yeah, but did you see how much he squats? It's like a lot.
Yeah.
It's a whole lot. He can squat the whole stadium.
I'm almost willing to bet that before Tim Tebow turns 40, he will be a WWE wrestler, and his whole shtick will be he brings out a cross and holy water, and he, like, throws it on Kane, because Kane will still be wrestling by then. He'll throw it on Kane. He'll say the power of Christ compels you, and then they'll wrestle. He'll win, of course.
Yeah, just I think he'd have a chance of making the Major League roster if he could squat on some pitches instead of swinging at all three Scherzer deliveries. I mean, that's the only at-bat that I've watched of his. And, I mean, that's not really fair. You know, you're throwing in a playoff-winning quarterback against Max Scherzer to hit a baseball. I'd like to see Max Scherzer cover Demaryius Thomas on that slant, you know?
I think Max Scherzer in the Football Hall of Fame.
Exactly. At least Tebow's giving it a shot. And since he is making the attempt, I'm going to say there is a shot that he makes the Mets' big league roster.
Oh, I think he makes it just for publicity, son. I'm honestly surprised he hasn't made it up sooner. Let's be honest here. The Mets suck. Nobody has fun watching the Mets. And the only year they were good was when the Royals beat them in the World Series.
Okay, this is going to be obvious. I bet the Mets will be bad this year. And then in September, they will have about, I don't know, 50 wins. And then they'll be like, I don't know, might as well. So they'll call him up. He'll hit .056. Then he'll go on Saturdays to SEC and remember how much fun analysting is.
Analysting.
No, but he's an analyst, and he's having fun being an analyst. So, analysting.
And if for nothing else, I mean, pregame speeches before baseball games, I think there's not very often that guys get to show a lot of emotion, but if there's going to be somebody in there who's yelling and hollering after every single pitch, it's going to be Tim. And I think baseball needs more of those guys.
One thing that's going to be good if he does get called up is if you're a pitcher, you should just... That's the one guy you know for a fact. You can beam whenever you want. He's never going to charge a mound because he's a turn-the-other-cheek guy. You know, he can never retaliate, so I just throw at him all day and just let him get beat up and then not want to play baseball anymore. And like you said, go back to analysting for the SEC Network.
Also, he looks pretty natural in blue and orange. That's Florida colors. He looks good. I just see a picture of him. I've seen at least four pictures of him wearing four different numbers. Here he's 83. He's 15. He's 90-something, and this 97, so I don't – that's wild. All wild numbers for baseball players.
He can't be 69 until he's married, so.
Good point. That's a good point.
I feel like if Tim Tebow were hit and he would charge the mound, he would charge the mound with a Bible and read his favorite verse to the pitcher and just be like, now doesn't that give you the strength to not throw at hitters anymore?
And on base percentage, way up. Baseball
that's
guy.
That's true. That spiraled out of control. Next question, win or lose this weekend, is Tiger Woods' performance a fluke, or does he have an actual shot to compete at the Masters? Thank you to Aiden from Omaha.
So this is sort of along the lines of, does Tebow have a shot of making the big league roster? Because I feel like there really is a shot. I think that Tiger Woods, he looks happy playing golf. Two weekends ago, the tournament that he played in, he looked really happy playing. He was in contention that entire time, and if he's feeling good, he's still a good golfer. So I am going to give him a shot.
any given Sunday, any given day. Tiger Woods, he used to be the best golfer. So any given day he goes out there, you've got to be aware of where Tiger Woods is on the standings, because he could go out there and win it out of nowhere, and people shouldn't be surprised anymore.
Is he still swinging like out of his body, though? Because I know that was the thing, the biggest strike with Tiger when he was younger. There was all the analysts said, he's swinging so hard, there's no way his back can keep up with him because he's just tearing up his back muscles. And he's had all these back problems coming into this, and that's what got him in trouble a little bit with all the pills and things. But is he does he still have that ability to swing that hard and not like destroy his back?
He had the third highest, actually, club head speed on tour. So, I mean, he's still swinging hard, but they fixed his swing so it's not hurting him as much. And I honestly think that if you're looking for a good bet, which I always am, Tiger Woods come Masters Sunday. Wouldn't be surprised. He'll flip the switch. He'll be in contention.
So are you telling us Tiger's back is back?
Tiger's back is back.
I think it all really depends on what he's wearing also. You all know when he's wearing the red shirt with the black hat, that's a good day for Tiger. He never has a bad day wearing that shirt and that hat combo.
Sunday special.
Yeah, Sunday special. So I'm with you. I never bet against Tiger depending on his outfit.
We're going to go ahead and dip into a little bit of NFL talk. This one's from Tyler and Lincoln. What is your prediction for the San Francisco 49ers with Jimmy Guwop and newly acquired Richard Sherman? Fellas, what do you think about the Niners?
They will give the Rams a run for their money. The Seahawks, I mean, you can't ever count them out as long as Russell Wilson's at the helm, but their defense is deteriorating. You saw them lose Richard Sherman to the Niners. They're listening to trades for Cam Chancellor, so the Legion of Boom is no more. The Cardinals, it's pretty sad to watch now. As if David Johnson's not there, Larry Fitzgerald is having everybody's backup quarterback throw him touchdown passes. So they're basically out of contention, too. But Jimmy Guwop gives the Niners a chance. And with the addition of Richard Sherman, their coaches are good. It'll be a battle between the Niners and the Rams, and I wouldn't be surprised if both of them make the playoffs next year.
One thing that I'm really anxious to see is he said that he's vengeful against the Seahawks. The Seahawks actually cut him. This wasn't like a trade between the 49ers and the Seahawks. They just cut him. He signed with San Francisco, who gets to play Seattle twice a year. I really want to see if Sherman, who he's not going to play in that system anymore where he just plays one side of the field. You assume he's going to follow best receiver. Him and Doug Baldwin, really good friends in Seattle. I kind of want to see, like, maybe we have a little Norman versus Odell thing, maybe. Maybe they stay buddy-buddy and talk like Xavier Rhodes and Antonio Brown did this year when they played each other. But I think those matchups there, that receiver versus defensive back matchup, when the 49ers play the Seahawks now, is going to be very entertaining. I think the 49ers as a team are going to be much improved. With that being said, I think a lot of the NFC teams are also improving. I think we saw the Vikings get better this offseason. I think we see the Saints just continuing growth. I think a lot of the teams in the NFC, such as the Rams, the Falcons, the Panthers, I mean, they're all going to be there next year. So that's going to be a really hotly contested race. And I know the 49ers, like, hype train and bandwagon, it's rolling strong right now. But it's so tough to tell in the NFC. It's not as clear-cut as Patriots, Steelers, or everybody else in the AFC. So we'll see. But I'm really excited to see Sherman in San Francisco, because seeing him in non-Seahawks colors, maybe I'll like him a bit more. Just slightly.
If I'm the Oakland Raiders, I do not schedule these two California NFC West teams, because you got Aqib Talib, who's just going to snatch Michael Crabtree's chain, and then you got Richard Sherman, who you don't put him on a sorry receiver like Crabtree. That's what happens. You don't put him on a sorry receiver like Crabtree. So they're going to have a tough time. If I'm the Raiders, I schedule all my out-of-conference games on the opposite side of the coast.
Oh, yeah, I agree completely. I think watching the matchup between Sherman and Crabtree is going to be awesome, because they're both such big personalities, such big egos. I think, like you said earlier, it's going to be like Josh Norman and Odell situation. There's going to be a lot of chatter going on, hopefully a lot of fights. I want to get back to the old Oakland days where they were fighting against every single team they played against. That was awesome. So I think that'd be cool to bring that back as well.
Will this still be Oakland next year?
Yeah. This will be Oakland next year.
Last year is Oakland,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, which is good, you know, because I think Oakland signing Marshawn Lynch, maybe he gave Crabtree, you know, who was Richard Sherman's, he almost fathered him for a little bit there in the NFC Championship game.
Right.
Maybe he's a dog now. He's had his chain snatched a few times. Maybe he's a dog now, and that Raiders and – I don't know if the Raiders and Niners play next year, but I think they play that one preseason game. But if he's bossed up And Michael Crabtree is feeling it. Marshawn Lynch has come in and turned him into a little bit of a G there. I could definitely begin to see some hands thrown on the field there.
Already the rivalry of the Niners and Raiders. The Niners won the coin toss over the Raiders for the 9th overall pick.
49ers still undefeated with Garoppolo.
That's true. Still undefeated. Last question here. Since it's spring break for us here, what athlete/athletes would you most like to go on spring break with? Thank you to Rob in Massachusetts for sending that one in.
Yeah, so the obvious pick here, Rob, would be somebody who shares your same name, Rob Gronkowski. He's a party animal. Hopefully he's still an athlete next year. Please do not retire. But going on spring break with Rob Gronkowski would be insane. He's got the party bus. Just a very entertaining guy on and off the field. He'd be awesome to party with. I think another person who would be really entertaining to go with, or a group of people, would just be LeBron and his crew on the banana boat. Banana boat. Chris Paul and Carmelo. And see, because, they're kind of the old guys now. Take them on like a spring break trip down to Gulf Shores or something and just see if the younger thems come out, or if Carmelo Anthony's still getting mad at people for playing music too loud like he did on the airplane down to Rio, that plane flight down there when he was getting mad at all the guys who were singing the Making My Way Downtown, Walking Fast.
One athlete I could think of that I definitely 100% want to go on spring break with, Fred Smoot. No doubt. 2/3 of the land is covered by water. The other third covered by Fred Smoot.
You taking a love boat with him, or are you just...
Definitely love boat. Gotta be love boat.
Yeah, in addition to Fred Smoot, why not just throw in Nate Burleson, Dante Cole, Pepper Bryant, McKinney? Just throw them all in. Let's just have... They know how to have a good time. I assume I'm not...
Allegedly.
Yeah, allegedly. They allegedly like to have a good time. You know, for my pick, I'm going to go with my two personal heroes to get both ends of the spectrum. I'm going to take Pat McAfee, and then I'm gonna take Tim Tebow.
Those are two very different athletes.
Because Pat McAfee will have a fun time, and then Tim Tebow will pray for us. So
you're covered.
I'm covered on all my bases.
I'm going kind of a different route here. I would think I want to go with someone like Brett Favre, because Brett Favre is gonna take you out on like a deep sea fishing trip, and I think that is like on my bucket list. One of the things I want to do more than anything in my life. Not a big party guy, but I do want to go deep sea fishing at some point. And also, if you ever watch when he's like mic'd up, he's got one of the best personalities ever in football. He's one of the funniest guys out there. He's got probably tons of great stories about things that happened back when he was playing and even before then, and things that have happened since. So I think he'd be a really fun guy just to hang out with, talk some football with, go fishing with. I think it'd be a cool dude to hang out with.
We should just have a segment called Guess Who's from Nebraska on this podcast. Talking about going fishing on spring break. So.
Yeah, you mentioned, though, mic'd up. That just brought to my head. John Randall is one of the guys who is one of the greatest mic'd up guys ever. We watched the Football Life, John Randall. Great documentary if you've not seen it. Look it up on YouTube, A Football Life from the NFL Network, John Randall.
I've got one more for you, because me and Tucker, we watched this interview last night. John Daly. I'd just like to spend a day with the man, because if the stories are true, the things he's doing are inhuman.
Outrageous.
Inhuman. John Daly, huge partier, wardrobe insane. And he's going to be that old guy that's going to set you up so much. Like, with any chick, just set you up. Nobody could do it better. John Daly, a day in the life. I would love it. Love to spend just one day with him.
Speaking of people who used to be really big partiers but are now sober, Johnny Manziel. He could be a good guy to go party with. You know, he could put you on the straight and narrow. You could just go work out with him for spring break. You see his Instagram stories of him working out just all the time, all mornings of the day.
True. I'd rather party with him than Baker. You know, if we're comparing the two flashy quarterbacks coming out of college there, because I know I'm not going to get body slammed by a cop if I party with Johnny, you know.
You know it'd be another fun guy to hang out with on spring break? Marshawn Lynch. First off, you're getting unlimited Skittles.
Oh, I love Skittles.
Unlimited Skittles, which is a top 10 necessity for spring break, is Skittles on every list you're going to see coming out from BuzzFeed or whoever puts those lists out. Another thing he's going to do, you're going out to California with him. There's going to be beach concerts, going to be everything. He's going to get you all the VIP treatment. Everyone in California loves Marshawn Lynch. Ever since he hijacked that cart and drove around at the University of California, everybody there loves him. They love his hijinks. They want to get him involved in as much things as possible. So I think hanging out with Marshawn Lynch is going to put you in with a good crew. You're going to have a great time on spring break. So if you get the opportunity, Marshawn Lynch on spring break, I would recommend it. Don't let that one pass you by.
That's a wrap to episode 7 of Nosebleed Radio. Follow us on Twitter @NosebleedSnow. Like us on Facebook, Nosebleed Knowledge. We'll see ya.